Good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming out to the town hall meeting that we're having tonight. Our focus is going to be on transit and transportation. I've got a several people panel that's going to come up and make a presentation for us. But seeing that we've got a little bit of a smaller crowd, what I'd like to be able to do before we get started with the presentation, is have just everyone go around, introduce who they are and what community they are from. So I'm Peter Fischer, Representative 43A. I'll start right over here with Mayor Emerson.
I'm Joe Emerson. I'm the mayor of White Bear Lake.
Nora Slavik, I'm the mayor of Maplewood.
Will Schroer, East Metro Strong.
And I'm Ron Anderson, president of Century College.
Corey Culver, student at Century College and president of Maplewood.
Mike Bruner, vice president for student services.
Yep, you.
Jen Wilson, resident and legal activist in Mahtomedi.
John Siegmeyer, just on the board of Mahtomedi and Grant.
Dale Tripler, Maplewood.
Joe Tripler, Maplewood.
Candy Marcus, Maplewood.
Lori Berg, Maplewood.
Dallas Pearson, Oakdale.
Thank you.
Ray Winoskis, White Bear Lake.
Bob Mankey, Birchwood.
White Bear. Sam Emerson.
Well, thank you all for taking time out of this beautiful evening to come here tonight. Transit transportation has been a big issue, and I've been hearing a lot of questions on it. And so what I wanted to do tonight is have the opportunity for us to have some people present some great information for us and have a dialogue and help answer people's questions and hear what people have to say about it. I'd like to start with Will from East Metro Strong to tell us a little bit about the efforts that they're working on, some of the efforts that they've got going, and a little bit about his organization.
Very good. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you for having me, Representative Fischer.
You're welcome.
Representative Fischer thought that it might be useful for me to throw a couple of slides up here. So if we can make this work, I saw a thing once, if President Lincoln had a PowerPoint, the Gettysburg Address, the first line would not have been forced. It would have been, is it F7? All right, I'm the executive director of a relatively new organization. I can't say new anymore, but relatively new organization called East Metro Strong. Mayor Emerson is on our board, and I thank her for her service in that. What I'd like to do today is tell you who we are and talk about why we think the East Metro needs a better transit system, and then why we think that investment would pay off for the East Metro and for the whole region and for everybody in it. So I'm gonna click through this. I hate people that apologize for going through slides, like that's the point. The point is to share information with you. So if you see anything that you wanna stop and talk about, just raise your hand and let me know. That's why we're here. So East Metro Strong, relatively new organization. The genesis was commissioners from Ramsey, Washington and Dakota and the mayor of St. Paul feeling like they didn't have a place to come together to talk about transit and economic development in the East Metro. I think that there was a feeling that Hennepin County does a better job at this because they're bigger. They are about the same size as we are, but all in one county and not quite as chopped up in so many little jurisdictions. And they thought that coming together around one table would be a helpful thing to do. So with some money from local philanthropy, we've come together and been joined by some local businesses, 3M and Health East, and I think it's a pretty exciting public-private partnership. Our goals are straightforward, if not easy to accomplish. More transit in the East Metro, and then not transit as an end in itself, but transit as a way to support economic development and vitality in the East Metro. And I'll spend most of my time here talking about how we would like to see that happen. But before I do that, a little sense of the urgency. The other thing that I hate about people presenting is when they say, I know that you can't read this, which makes me want to say, why are you showing it? But if you can squint and look at this, this is a map of urban passenger rail systems around the country, all to exactly the same scale. So here's Chicago, and they've got a big, L and subway system, and New York obviously has a million lines. Here's us. There's the blue line that runs to the airport, and looks like a little nose there. There's the airport. There's the green line connecting with St. Paul. And I show this map because, and don't get me wrong, I think the blue line and the green line are fantastic, but folks, we are behind. We are behind, and the 3M was just in the paper 2 weeks ago saying, you know, 30% of our guys are going to retire soon. We need to recruit people to replace them. And our recruits are looking at this map, right? Where do I want to live? That's what the 3M candidates are looking at. And they're saying, well, if I move to Minneapolis, I can, you know, maybe take this. But if I move to these other places, I can move around the whole region. I have real options. And so that's, we're not in a competitive situation at that point. And the second thing is, of course, that these folks are not, around the country are not saying, you know what, St. Paul and Minneapolis, we need to give them a chance to catch up. We're going to stop building new rail lines. That's not, they're built, they're, every one of these cities is not stopping where they are. They're continuing to build because it works for them. Before I had this job, I worked for the Chamber of Commerce, and they run a leadership visit to a different city every year. And we went to Denver 2 years ago. And we could not have a meeting in Denver without hearing the exact same story. And, you know, this was the Denver folks. We weren't saying, tell us X or Y. They were wanting to tell us their story. 10 years ago, they had a not very diversified economy. You know, it was kind of tourism, and it was extraction, you know, timber, et cetera, mining. And those things would boom and bust. And they said, we don't want a boom and bust economy anymore. We want a modern, diversified economy. How do we get that? Incredible reliance on new talent. And that new talent wanted transit, so they spent 10 years building new transit. And now, they are the number one destination in the country for new for millennials. And we're number 39. So they're very proud of that story, and that's the same story that I would like us to be able to tell in a couple of years. But we've got some work to do to get there. So I can tell Denver's story, but that's maybe not as interesting or compelling to some people as it is to me. So this is a map from the University of Minnesota's Accessibility Laboratory, which I think is a nice name, Accessibility Observatory. And not surprisingly, you can get to a lot of jobs in a half hour from downtown Minneapolis because that's where all the transit lines meet. And then in downtown St. Paul, you can get to a much smaller number of jobs within a half an hour during the morning commute. But after that, it falls off pretty rapidly. And in order for us to draw the people and the jobs that we need in the East Metro, this map needs to look a lot different. It needs to look a lot different. And so that's the local sense of urgency that we have. This is what we have today. If, just to give the baseline, you probably know it, but there's here again is the blue line, the red line bus rapid transit running down to Lakeville, and then of course we're very excited about the 6 months old green line. But we need a lot more in these three counties. Now, East Metro Strong not brought together in explicit competition with Hennepin County. I don't want anyone to get that sort of sense, but I hear, well, Hennepin County has more people, more businesses, and more need for real transit. That's why they got the blue line. That's why they're getting Botno and Southwest, et cetera. And it turns out actually not to be true. They've got more people and jobs now, but we are growing faster. And by 2040, the three eastern counties will have a larger population than Hennepin will have by 2040. And we need to get ready for that. And you know, these projections, the joke is it's always difficult to make projections, especially about the future, right? These people won't necessarily absolutely come. If they don't have an opportunity to get around, to get to jobs and recreation and their homes without sitting in a lot of traffic, they're not going to come. Then they will move to Hennepin County, or they will move to Denver, or they will move to San Francisco. So this is a trend that I hope will come true, but it won't come true all by itself. So what was East Metro Strong doing? We're bringing together the folks that I showed you and then stakeholders who would like to become involved to create a vision about how transit can serve the East Metro. So you may have seen a variation on this map. We redrew it just a little bit. We're not in the business of drawing new transit lines. We're working with folks that are doing that hard work. But we're drawing them all together. And so our hope is to serve all of these new people and to help the transit planners that are drawing these lines by talking about how they'll all work together. So this is the gold line, which is the furthest along in the planning, and it's been approved by all the cities along it. It goes from St. Paul out to Woodbury. Red Rock down to Hastings, Robert Street, at least through West St. Paul into northern Dakota County, and may go further. Riverview between downtown St. Paul, the airport, and the Mall of America. This is running, of course, and then going north through this area, the Rush Line Corridor, also moving along. We've drawn in, or other people have drawn in, a couple of other corridors here that are in sort of light yellow that may eventually come to fruition. The Highway 36 corridor here out to Stillwater, and then another one out 35. So those are maybe in the future, but we're concentrating on the five that I just mentioned: the Gold Line, Red Rack, Rabbit, Riverview, and Rush. We are excited about those lines because we think they will link an enormous chunk of what's great about the East Metro together. And some of these maps, actually, you're some of the first people to see. So apologies to my board member, but I like to share information when I get it. Mayor Emerson, if you see anything here that concerns you, let me know. So you saw the nice lines, and these lines are not as thin and definite because as you probably know from the reading about Rush Line, they don't know exactly where it's going to go here, right? So they've outlined a planning corridor, so that's why this area is not as well defined as, say, the Gold Line. The Gold Line, they know where it's going to go. It's been approved by the cities, and so we can draw a very definite line. So these stripes are, this is where the line's going to go, and then a 5-minute walk to the line, a 5-minute bicycle to the line, and a 5-minute drive to the line. And that's the area that will be served by the line. Now, more than that will be served because there'll be feeder buses.
I'm
gonna
wash my hair.
See, she's got to go wash her hair. There it is. No worries. So we added up all of the folks that live and work in these six corridors. And it totals up to just under 600,000 people, which is more than half of the folks that live in the whole three-county area, which is pretty remarkable. These five lines, just these slices, capture more than half of the population of the three counties. And ditto for the jobs, serve more than half the jobs in the three counties. And if you think about it, you know, we think of the three counties as being pretty well-developed, but there's a lot of agriculture still in Dakota County. There's a lot of agriculture still in Washington County. And so I had no part in drawing these lines. I like to think that the transit planners who are drawing those lines have done a heck of a good job. They have found where the centers of activity in the East Metro are and are proposing to serve those. A little bit more, I shouldn't say surprising, but pleasantly surprising, I guess, is that in these corridors, they hit a lot of the regional centers of activities. The hospitals, the universities, this is one. A lot of other neighborhood retail centers where you do your daily business, and then a lot of parks and preserves. Now, my GIS guy, you know, tells the computer, find all the parks and preserves. I'm like, 400 parks? And he's like, what can I tell you? There are a lot of little parks in St. Paul that you can get to now within these transit corridors. And then the last thing that I kind of hear when I talk to folks about why we need transit in the East Metro is, yeah, but these places are kind of built out already. And so we send the GIS guy back to work, and it turns out that, just in these corridors, I'm not talking about the less developed parts of Dakota, you know, down by Hastings, I'm talking in these corridors, 40 square miles of undeveloped land that is... Right, not developed. So now some of that is in wetlands, some of that is on steep slopes, so you tell the GIS guy to take that out. Now we're down to 32 miles, square miles of green field. But then we redevelop every year a little bit as well. And historically, this is your only question, it's kind of a wonky question, I'm just curious, I'm always interested in people's thoughts on this. How much of the region do you think is redeveloped in 1 year as a percentage? Any guesses, any takers? We were talking statistics earlier.
2%.
1%. Historically, it's 1%. So the whole thing would turn over, you know, in 100 years. Historically. We think that it's picking up and that's a conservative estimate, as you guys guessed as well. You think it's probably twice that. But conservatively, if 20% of this corridor turns over, that's another 8 miles, square miles, so we're back to 40 square miles. That's an enormous area that can be built in these corridors. So there's a lot of people and jobs there now, and there's room to add a lot more. So we think that these are great lines, and we're excited to tell this story. One thing missing, what is it? it's better transit. And only 28% of all of this activity, population, and jobs is being served by seven-day transit right now. And whatever the right number is, it's not 28%. So we think there's a real need. We think there's a real opportunity. And finally, so that we don't have to tell Denver's story, we can tell our own story about how investing in transit in East Metro produces real return on investment because we can look at the green line. There's a popular talking point that light rail or bus rapid transit, real bus rapid transit, high quality dedicated transit just replaces the regular buses. And so, yeah, maybe it's nicer, but you're not putting any more people into public transit. And the Green Line has absolutely proven that to be incorrect. You add up all the bus riders a year ago, and there are three different lines that serve University Avenue. All of the ridership buses plus LRT this year, and it's gone up by 50%. If you add new high quality public transportation, new people will take it and they'll take it more often. Yes, ma'am?
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
I've been on the Green Line just once, but I was told that all University of Minnesota students get free passes. The professors get free passes. A lot of the staff get free passes. So yes, you are going to increase your ridership, but you're not increasing your revenue.
They got those before the Green Line opened, so they could have been using those on buses.
But they're using it on the Green Line.
Yeah.
And they get it for free.
The university pays the Metro Transit for those passes.
And they pay X amount of dollars on the dollar, or X amount of cents on the dollar. So
yeah.
I'm saying the revenue does not necessarily increase by 50% when you increase your membership. Okay? And I've also looked into this, and I've been reading that the Green Line is costing us $1 billion a month.
That could be.
Okay? So, I mean, you know, it's all wonderful and great for all these rails and everything, but the problem for me is that you're increasing all of this, but where is the revenue to pay for it?
Well, that's a great question.
Okay.
That is not the subject of my talk, but I'm happy to.
I understand. You're trying to sell the line.
Right. No, but I'm happy to, and I don't.
And I think that's one of the things that we can talk about after we get done with the presentation.
Yeah,
that would be something good to hear about people's thoughts along those lines. So,
no, it's a fine question. And you know, I think that it's fair to say that that any major transit investment, it's true of most major road investments for that matter, true of most major infrastructure investments, airport, rail, etc., have dual purposes of moving people or stuff or something else and being a magnet for economic development. Whenever I go hear the guy at the airport talk, he's like, we move a lot of people and we produce so much economic development for Minnesota because if you don't have an airport, that's kind of the game. And they're dual purposes. And to assign all of the cost to one thing or another is always a challenge. So the current figure on the development that's been drawn to the Green Line is $2.5 billion. You know, you can move that number one way or the other depending on various arguments. I like to quote Jim Stolpestad. He's putting his own money into these buildings and saying, I wouldn't be here if it weren't for this line because it makes a difference. So I think there's a good story to tell. I think further away from the line, I just came from a meeting in Lake Elmo. They have very strong views in Lake Elmo about what they want to do with most of Lake Elmo. And they're very excited about the fact that the Gold Line will draw some kinds of growth to the Gold Line, and they'll leave the rest of Lake Elmo alone. And I think that that's what a comprehensive vision for the region does. It doesn't make every place in the region look exactly the same. It lets some places be some places and other places be other places. So I think that's part of that vision. So we are trying to tell a story. We're working with a lot of other people. As I said before, we're not drawing these lines, but we're helping the folks in the East Metro talk about what these lines would do for the East Metro and then think about what kind of growth and development they would like to see around them. What do we want to see in those 40 square miles of open land that are in these corridors? You can build one kind of thing in them, or you can talk to people about building another way. And we're here to facilitate that conversation along with a lot of other people. So I'm going to be followed by folks that are much more in the trenches, the two mayors. who report to a different set of people than I do. I'm excited to hear what they have to say, but this is what East Metro's drawing is up to and why we're excited about a better transit system for the East Metro. Representative,
thank you. I think you did a great job of helping getting some of the initial information out. And I think that's one of the things that we're going to hear next is we're going to have Mayor Slawick come up and talk a little bit about what is happening on the movement side. And she's also involved a little bit. People have questions on one of the corridors is on Rush Line, too. So I will give her an opportunity to kind of get a couple of things at the same time. So
thank you. And we kind of feel like we're on the transportation tour these days because we see Will at a lot of things. And actually, Joe and I testified the Senate Transportation Committee came out to Woodbury last week. So we have our comments a little bit written up. So we hope that is okay. One thing I want to say is what mayors are doing a lot these days is transportation. Of my responsibilities, I'm on the TAB, and if everybody knows, the TAB is the Transportation Advisory Board of the Met Council, so they give a lot of the metro funding out. Very complicated group to sit on, but very interesting. I'm also the PAC chair for the Rush Line, so that's the Policy Advisory Chair, so those are the people that really make the differences, and I sit on the Gateway Corridor Commission. So when Gateway went through its process, sort of the PAC is what guides through those final decisions. So just to say, we're deeply immersed in transportation in Maplewood right now. A little bit about statewide what's going on is there's a group called Move Minnesota, which has been out statewide talking about transportation. And one of the things they asked mayors to do that we did in Maplewood was meet with businesses. So we had two meetings. Matt Kramer from the St. Paul Chamber helped organize businesses, and we met in Maplewood. And then Peter came out. We had one in White Bear, right? And Joe, you were there at some really
Washington Square.
And I thought that was a really good meeting. And the White Bear Chamber is very active, and they had a lot of questions. And I got a lot of support for transportation initiatives. What Move Min is, it's a statewide coalition of more than 200 businesses, organizations, and local governments that have called for a 10-year commitment to fixing Minnesota's bridges, improving state highways and local roads, and expanding access to transit and creating safer routes to schools and work. So it's a very broad coalition. And I think that everybody agrees that an efficient, reliable transportation system is essential to Minnesota's economic competitiveness. And Will talked a little bit about that, especially with transit, but making all of our systems work better together. I know you were also, right, Ron, you were at the White Bear Chamber, right. And you talked about students. You know, I don't know if any of you have driven out on Century before classes start. What is it, about 7:30, 8 o'clock? It's backed up all the way over on the other side. And so I think that's a real demonstration of, you know, some of the issues. And 3M, you know, getting their goods and services, you know, out of their complex, you know, how backed up everything is and how that takes away from our businesses. So by 2025, Minnesota's entire transportation system will be on life support as congestion, reliability, and safety concerns put our state's long-term economic health at risk. So I want to thank Peter Fischer for having this forum. I think this is a really big issue, and thanks for the work that you're doing, you know, for our community and our area, because I think we have a lot of local examples. According to MnDOT, more than 65% of the state's roads and 40% of the bridges will be more than 50 years old by 2025, so you think about that. And you think about what happened right with our bridge here in Minnesota, and so it's something we don't want to think about happening again. They long surpass their lifespan. And compounding the problem, freight semi-truck traffic is projected to increase by 30%, and the state will have about 430,000 additional residents. Movement supporters are urging state leaders like Peter and his colleagues to support a 10-year plan with new long-term funding. So what's in there? You know, you asked about the funding, so I'm going to mention some of the funding that at least Movement's calling for and how it would come for. But the reality is when the election happened and we now have divided government, right, which is Minnesota often has, Democrats and Republicans, probably not going to be as big of a year for transportation as maybe many of us hoped. Because there's the surplus to do a lot of these things they are proposing tax increases, and I'm not sure that that's going to pass. We'll see what happens. So some of the things are applying the state sales tax to the price of fuel. So Movement is proposing adding the state's 6.5% sales tax to the price of fuel. So that would be one way to generate some income. Now we know that gas is down for all of us, and it's about $2.50 right now, a little bit higher than that. It went down below that, but when a lot of these proposals came out, it was higher. So it's people are a little more receptive to that. Increasing the Twin Cities 7 county sales tax. The current quarter cent sales, metro sales tax has helped build the new green line, so that was part of what built it. There was a quarter cent sales tax raised in the metro that's given out by CTIP, which is a group that divides that up. What does CTIP stand for?
Counties Transit Improvement Board.
Counties Transit Improvement Board. So they split that up, and a lot of that went to the green line, and it also goes to the red line, BRT, from Apple Valley to Mall of America, and to fund half the cost of operating the region's transit ways. So that's funding that. The sales tax is not enough to build the transit system, and the region needs to foster long-term economic development. Now, one kind of interesting thing is being on the TAB is actually kind of a controversial body. We have the exurban counties, right? Carver County, the ones that are farther out, even Washington to some degree, that are really concerned about where that money is going. And you have the inner cities, the inner counties, Hennepin and Ramsey are concerned, but there's equity factors that are put into that funding. And so that becomes a big fight about equity. So does equity benefit the metro area more than it benefits the outer urban areas, right? So the reason I mention this is the TAB becomes this kind of closely divided group that votes very, you know, within one vote. So this sales tax is actually controversial. And in doing it countywide, and then guess who administers it? This was my question at the TAB, the Met Council. And so we know that there's new leadership at the Met Council. We're excited about Adam Dunick, I am. However, there's still some skepticism about the effectiveness of the Met Council and their ability to manage things well. So that's the part. I don't know, Peter, when you're voting on this, or if you even get to vote on this, if it makes its way through, I wonder if the administrative part will be changed somehow. Or if I hope sort of that maybe it goes to the CTIP, so that an existing group could allocate those funds, because they're metro-wide, right? Instead of using through the Met Council to do that. So this gets kind of complicated with the funding. Another one that they're talking about is adjusting license tab fees. We know that it was Jesse, right? Wasn't it Jesse that brought down the license tab fees? And that was kind of his thing. And so, you know, people have paid higher, and part of, you know, getting funding and doing things may be tabs, but we know that does hit everybody, so for some people it will hit them a little bit harder. And some of the other things we're just looking at are on the plate are the funding for the local streets and safer routes to school and work. You know, in Maplewood, and I know we have a big Maplewood contingent here, we're getting a safer route to school. It's going to be along County Road B, where John Glenn is. You know, there's a lot of kids that are walking to school there, and monies from Safer Routes to School are already allocated that are going to be build a sidewalk there this year. So we're pretty big on connectivity and trying to connect all our trails and our roads and all those types of things. So I think this coalition has really done a lot of work, and if you want more information about it, I would go on to the website for Movement. They were, you know, again, more hopeful maybe before the election started, but I think there's still a lot of hope that this could be the year for transportation, because it's something we really need a big investment on. You know, today, if I can mention this, I heard on the radio, one of our senators that represents parts of this area, a little bit south of here, is Susan Kent, was on talking about that they formed a new purple caucus. And that purple, you know, so you think, what's purple, right, in the country when they talk about purple? So it would be the combination of blue, Democrat, and red, Republican, and what color do you get? Purple, right? So a purple caucus, and they're going to support three things: education, transportation, and
child protection.
And so I think that could be a really interesting group, and maybe that'll get some of these initiatives forward. One thing as a former legislator that I've learned is it's a place of increments, right, Peter? So you can propose great big packages, but do the great big packages pass? Not so much. Little pieces of the package pass. So if we can get some of this through, and I do think that Metro sales tax, if we can get it administered the right way and get it out, that would be one of the biggest helps to the metro area. Because if you come home, I don't know if you have to go down 94 going east at 5 o'clock, but it's, you know, it can be 45 minutes to an hour to get home. I'm sure Century was getting a little bit backed up tonight. He must have night classes, right? Yeah. So they're all coming up now, and sometimes you gotta, I know we should talk about that whole road up there. And there's, I'm sure you have a lot of conversation about that, but how to get that.
Yeah, we did a lot of talk about 128.
Yeah, widening it up. So that's my part. I want to thank Peter again for his leadership. I hope you'll all stay tuned on transportation. You know, when it comes time, you have to call him up and make sure he knows what you're thinking. But I hope, you know, what I hear a lot, Peter, is actually, as a mayor, I'm surprised I get a lot of calls about the roads. I get people that talk about their pavement cracking, about their potholes, about they want to ride their bike to 3M and they can't get to work. South Maplewood went through this era of when pavements was ecologically mixed and it was not done very well, and so it's all cracking and paving down there. And you all know, being residents, that when your city does a new road, you're assessed. And so their roads are breaking down a lot faster than the rest of the city. So we appreciate your leadership and hope something's going to happen this year. So thank you.
Thank you, Norm.
Sure.
Next person I'm going to have speak to us is Mayor from White Bear Lake, Joe Emerson. She's covering an 84% coalition, which I think starts getting more into what we were hearing a little bit from Norm about the roads and that type of thing.
I'm sticking with the local road.
There you go. There you go.
I'm also the president of the Minnesota Mayors Association. I serve on the East Metro Strong Board and the League of Minnesota Cities. So I hear about transportation both metro and statewide. But the 84% coalition is Mayors for Municipal Roads. And this is a 23-person coalition from mayors from around the state, big cities, small towns. And what we are saying is that 84% of city streets are paid for by property taxes and assessments. And if you think about it, almost every, the first and last mile of almost every trip you take is taken on a city street. So that's our, and when a street's being done for being resurfaced, it's not just a simple matter of throwing down some asphalt and paving the road. We take care of our sewers, our water lines. Generally, the XL comes in and does something with the gas lines and utilities. Then we also have to look at street lights, traffic signals, railroad crossings, ADA compliance. So quickly, a street project, a simple street project, becomes very expensive. Some cities have what's called MSA, Municipal Street Aid, and that means certain streets in our city are designated to receive funding. I believe it's 9% we receive from the license tab fund. I think it's 9% cities that get this MSA funding. But if a county or a state comes in to do a project, sometimes we have to pay a portion of that, and sometimes we have to use our MSA money for that, and then we have to delay a project we were going to do, because sometimes they come in with little notice that they're coming, and all of a sudden we have to scramble. And there's any city under 5,000, which is, there's over 700 in the state, do not receive MSA money. So they are really hurting. They really are having a hard time. Another thing that I'll throw in just in the middle of this, I think you will agree, we do not have regular, accurate, you know, adequate bus service. We in the suburbs are really hurting. We cannot count on buses. Metropolitan Council mandates that we do affordable housing in our communities, a certain percentage in a 10-year period. Well, as I told someone from the Met Council, it makes no sense for us to build affordable housing when they don't have reliable transportation. Why would we plunk them out here and they can't get to work? So I said, those two have to go hand in hand. And, you know, the cities are unique. We're not, one thing, it's not going to work for, what works for one city will not work for all cities. And but what this 84% coalition is asking, we are asking for additional, dedicated, and stable funding. So so that we can count on this money being there, so that we can plan our projects, keep our streets well, because we, you know, between paving, we do mill and overlay. We try to maintain our streets. My city, we do 2.5 to 3 miles of street every year, plus mill and overlay projects. But then if the county or the state comes in, then we have to figure out how we're going to do something. We had to delay a mill and overlay last year because of Highway 61. We try to do it. We're trying to be good stewards. We're trying to keep our infrastructure, but we can't continue on this pace. So that is what the 84% coalition is about.
Thank you. Well, thank you to our presenters. I appreciate it. More things that I'll toss out that I've learned as I've been learning more about transit transportation is some of the things that make it a little bit more complicated in this state is people say, well, why are we always looking for money? Well, there's a couple of things. Is the way our gas tax is based right now, which provides most of the funding, is coming from when we use it. Purchase it for our cars. And the thing is when you take a look over the last 10, 15 years, cars are getting more efficient. I just replaced a car that's no longer on the road, and the old vehicle is getting about 18 miles per gallon, the new one gets 28. So in effect, I'm still driving the same amount I was before, but the amount that I was paying gas taxes has dropped substantially. And so I still have the same amount of wear and tear. And so our funding source has changed. So we have to kind of figure out how do we be more sustainable. And another thing that causes us as a state, we're an outlier on how many roads we have. In our state, we have the fifth largest road network in the nation. And our population is about 28. You know, we're down in the middle. So when you think about that inequity back and forth, we've made a real commitment. Part of it is because we've got a large rural section where we've got a lot of agriculture going on. We've got a lot of mining. We've got a lot of timber. So when you get out, you've got a lot of small communities that need this infrastructure. And we need at that point, then you need the highways to get the goods moved back and forth. So as a result, that has us in this kind of real unusual situation that's going to cause us to be an outliner, having to put more into that kind of structure. And so that's one of the things that is going to make it a little bit harder when you compare it to the surrounding states. You go to North Dakota and South Dakota, they've got, you know, while they've got large states, many of the roads they don't maintain on a year-round basis. Here we do. You know, so these are some of the things that gets real hard when we're trying to compare things back and forth between states. But this is where it gets into the discussion and conversation part. You know, we've had a chance to hear a lot of things. This is something that is going to be coming up before us. And there may be other issues and concerns that people may have. And so what I want to do is kind of open it up for people to be able to provide their input. That's why I'm here tonight is I've learned a couple more things tonight. It seems anytime I go to one of these, I'm learning more information. So I thank our presenters on it. Ray, you've got your hand.
Yeah, I've got a question for you. I was asked to ask you this question. Why are not bicyclists licensed?
You know, I don't know. That's a good question.
Because the reason I'm asking is because horses have to have a license to go on any state trail or any road now. So if a horse has to do it, I would assume why not? I mean, you want revenue. Yeah. Why not the bicyclists? We want to spend $40 million a year for bicycle paths. And that's one thing I would not do. Spend that $40 million a year right now. Not when it's such a dire thing that we need our roads and bridges repaired.
Okay, well, thank you for that. I had not heard that one. That's a good one to toss on. Make sure to bring that forward. Other questions or things that are problems that that people here may experience, or yes?
What are you hearing about the surplus? And you know, some people are talking transportation for that.
A lot of things back and forth there, because everybody wants part of the surplus. There's one group that says give it all back. There's another group that is taking a look at what's happening in the human services side. There's when you take a look at what's happening in nursing homes over the last 10 years, nursing homes had an inflation rate of 25%, but their funding only went up about 8%. And so we've had nursing homes that are closing. And to try to address that problem just in the next 2 years, they're figuring we'll take about $250 million to try to keep the nursing homes open. And they only have two areas of funding that come in, the state or the feds. And so they've kind of got a limited pool. And same with the personal care tenants doing that same thing. Between the two of them, that's almost $500 million. You know, so when you start taking a look, and then you start going further out, those numbers jump a lot. There's people saying we want more into education. One of the things that I've heard very clearly is people saying,
and I was hearing it here tonight, we want to find a funding source that is stable for transportation. And I hear some people saying, well, we should take some of that surplus and put it in that. And that kind of makes sense because, you know, you've got some flexibility, but there seems to be a support of saying, we need something that's a little bit more consistent, but what does that look at like? You know, as we talked before, you know, the gas tax as we're driving, you know, is going down. So that's a declining resource. So how do we approach that in a more equitable situation? How do gas, you know, how do vehicles that don't use gas pay for it? Right now, all they've got are their license plate fees they pay for. You know, that's another part of the equation. Or the alternative fuels that are used. Some use propane, some use other fuel sources. So they're not paying the gas tax. So it gets, you know, and I'm just tossing out, these are the things I'm hearing. I'm not saying I've got solutions, but I'm just saying these are different things that people are talking about, trying to figure out what does make more sense. What are other ways that we try to approach it? And also, what are some of the problems that we haven't run into yet or are concerns? You know, one of the thoughts is the bike lanes. Man, that sounds like something worth looking at, particularly as we get into the state trails and those kind of things. I know we've got folks here from Century College. Yes, sir.
State trails, is that under the DNR? I asked the same question last week, and I got the answer. It's the DNR that runs the trails.
And I'd say most of them, and the reason I hesitate a little bit on the trails, because some of what people think are state trails are more regional trails, which may come from the regional park system. And those are usually, when they're being built, are funded by that 3/8 of 1% out of the legacy funds, the amendment funds. Take care of building some of those, but the thing it does not address is how do we take care of maintaining those in the future when it comes time to replace them. And that's kind of where we are with our roads right now. If you take a look at our roads, you know, we've got them building, but now it's time to start replacing them for the future. So how do we fund that going forward?
I guess one of my questions is when you bring up the legacy program, the legacy issue was supposed to be about water and keeping good habitat. And it's been sucked dry by everything else. I mean, my problem is that taxes seem to go everywhere but where they're supposed to go. We had a tax increase on gas that just finished up in 2012. Where did that money go? I looked all over on the computer to find information on it, and it's like it never happened. Where did that money go? Does anybody have an idea where it went?
It's
shut.
Pretty darn clear that money was invested in bridges all over the state.
Are you sure that's not the federal money? Because the federal money was given in 2008, and that was a lot of federal money that went for the bridges then.
A lot of that went to the 35W bridge, but as bridges get done, a lot of it is we've got a state share that we have to match across, and when they're redoing the highways across the area, the bridges are the most expensive part as you're doing them in.
And I guess if you want to just go back and read the bill passed, it specifically lays out that percentage that has to be spent on bridges. That was a priority. We fixed many, many bridges across the state that the money's been invested.
So we fixed all those bridges in 2012, and now in 2014 they're no good?
No, the bridges are fine, ma'am.
Oh, okay. Because we're being told we need more bridges.
What's not fine, as you know, are a vast network of roads that are falling apart.
It's not a bridge.
What you completely understand is true.
Yeah. Okay.
And I think I think one of the things that is coming up here is that there were a number of bridges at the time that were labeled as deficient that need to be addressed. Right. The thing is, though, is the infrastructure that we have elsewhere continues to age. So, like a road that right now is fine in 10 years is going to, or 15 years, depending on the age, is going to need to be replaced. And the bridges are usually somewhere between a 25 and 50 year cycle. And so, as we go down the road, we're always going to be having bridges every year that are going to need to be replaced and roads that are always going to need to be replaced. So, in some ways, it's going to feel like we're never really going to catch up because once you build it, it starts coming apart. And, you know, and I think, Dr. Anderson, you see that with your facility here. You know, it first went up way back in the 70s, and you've got some newer parts that are doing fine, but you've got some of the older parts that need to be updated. And if you don't do that, they fall into disrepair. And I've seen that at the university. If they don't keep up the buildings, they end up having to tear them down, which is a huge waste. And that's kind of what's happening with our roads.
I can understand that, but my point is then, as a legislator, I mean, I would want the legislators to make sure that there's money set aside for those kinds of things. Like in White Bear Lake, like she had said, we do so many roads every year.
Right.
I mean, why are, you know, it's like we spend the money, it's gone, and then we spend it on something else. And I don't have that kind of money. you know?
I appreciate hearing that, and I appreciate, and that's why I'm here, is to hear what people's concerns are, so I appreciate you bringing it up. Yes, sir.
Well, I just saw an ad on TV where the controlling party wants to give these excess taxes back, saying, well, wouldn't everybody like to get $134 back, and you could spend it on your whatever you want? Well, yeah, I could go in and get my front end realigned, or I could maybe repair some of the tires and wheels that have been destroyed by potholes. But I think it's kind of ironic that one party wants to give back excesses and look good to the voters and then not pay for anything or not do anything with what they have until they run the economy into a deficit. And then they turn it over to the other party, and we finally repair all the deficits and get it all fixed, and we try to make, you know, some headway on repairing bridges and roads and infrastructure, which has been neglected for the last 20 years. And now they want to give the money back that they finally got. And I just, it's like the guy sitting on the porch fiddling away in the sunlight, and the guy comes by and says, well, I thought your roof had a hole in it. Well, yeah, but it's not raining, so why would I work on it? You know, it just doesn't make any sense.
Back in the corner there, and then over to Dr. Anderson.
I'm having a real hard time with that comment because, frankly, the budget for the state has gone up every year, despite the fact that there was all the whining that went on about how it was cut back so much, which was merely a cutback in the rate of growth. You increased the taxes, what was it, $3 billion a couple of years ago? Now you're talking about another, was it $6 billion in the next biennium from
I think it was over 10 years, proposing over 10 years.
10 years.
A system that would raise $6 billion over 10 years.
Okay. The point is, the taxes keep going up year after year. I'm sorry, my salary doesn't go up that fast. Get some kind of proportion in your comments, for crying out loud.
Well, the party.
Well, let's all let, you know, we're starting to deviate a little bit from where we're supposed to be on transportation.
Yeah, let's stick to transportation. You know,
I think Dr. Anderson had a something.
Just from where I stand and working with students like Corey at the college, you know, here at Century, in a given year, we educate between 23 and 24,000 in different individuals in credit and non-credit programs. And as we know, you know, the traffic on
Century
Avenue becomes an issue. But a growing concern for us is the stories that we hear from many of our students who try to get to school in public transportation, and frankly, who do it and are a heck of a lot more resilient than I would have been, because they're taking bus trips from Minneapolis to one place in St. Paul to another place and another place, and they're spending an hour. I'll have students tell me I spend an hour and a half to 2 hours a day on the bus one way, and they come. And I think, you know, when I was 18, I wouldn't have done that. Or if I was in my 20s, I wouldn't have done that. I mean, it's very impressive to me. I think, thank God we got those folks here. But that's a real issue for us in terms of access. And it kind of in the same line of what Mayor Emerson's comments about, as we look at the changing demographics, and we have more students coming from backgrounds of poverty, the public transportation is the way that we need to be moving folks. It'll help us, on the one hand, be less of a nuisance to our neighbors, frankly, on the traffic standpoint.
I hear a lot about that.
Yeah, so do I. That's a significant piece, but more importantly, it's the access for our students. And our students come from all over the metro area. We certainly draw most closely from the East Metro, but they're coming from everywhere. And where our students are getting hurt is that they can't reliably get here. And I think the slide you had showing the buses, you know, how many routes actually go 7 days a week, they're really, really small numbers. And you may be able to get here, it's not impossible, but it certainly isn't easy and it's not straightforward. So that's the concern that I want to voice on behalf of our students and the real need.
Can you give me a little bit of idea of your diversity? What kind of your student population? What's the diversity of your population?
Currently now, in our credit student body, which is about 14,000 students a year, we are about 37% students of color, the remaining Caucasian students, and half of our students qualify for Pell Grants, which are the, it's a rough indication of socioeconomic status. It varies by family situations, but
that was
50%, right, of the students financially. And that has grown. In the last decade, we've seen huge changes in the demographics And on the great side is that shows we're expanding access, which is wonderful. That's what we're here to do. But we have to not only give the access, we have to provide the context so students can succeed, which means we have to be able to provide the services and have flexibility in terms of transportation and other things.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, along the same lines, one of the issues that I've always had is I have tried taking the bus from my house. I can take it at 8 o'clock in the morning. I'm into St. Paul, and that's the only place I can go. And at 5 o'clock at night, I could catch the bus and head back to my home. Unfortunately, I changed where I work, and I'm now in the opposite direction, so there is nothing. Everything that I see is for major feeder systems based on trains, which does absolutely nothing for that kind of an issue. And it's exactly the issue that the gentleman from Century was bringing up. There is nothing to improve the feeder system, and there's nothing to improve the fact that if you get from point A to point B, a train 10 miles south is going to help for one leg of something that takes three times as long to get there and back. That's the biggest problem I see, and I see these plans do nothing for that.
One of the things, and I'm going to defer back to the folks who are here, but one of the things that I've been hearing from some of the folks is as they have described it like a wheel spokes going out, and then you have your, you know, the hard line spokes, whether it's rail or bus rapid transit, I think is the other option that they look at, and then they have feeder lines that circulate around so that you're able to go from one line to the other, and I'll defer the folks over here that may know a little bit more is what's how that, you know, what's being looked at long term. Yes, well.
So that's a big and common concern, and I think there has been some concern that in an effort to catch up on some of the transitway that we're behind in the transitways, not enough money was put into improving the regular route bus system. And I'll let Mayor Slawick talk about Move Minnesota, but if she wishes, but there is a very significant portion of that proposal that would go straight to regular route bus system and to improve the regular route bus system, serve you, not for feeder routes to transitways, but just to serve, just to improve the regular route bus system. And I think that's been a concern that's been heard and responded to. I don't know if you want to add to that.
If I could, just one comment question on your earlier slide you had in there. You did have a comment that said the traffic along University went up 50% from the train, from train and bus. Mm-hmm. Was there a division as to where that was? Was it the train? Was it the bus? Because I deal with statistics all the time,
yeah.
And to me, that's what I classify as naive happenstance data or analysis. The two may not be linked, although you link them in a logical argument for illogical reasons. Is the problem,
sure.
I've got.
No, there was a 37,000 person jump in total ridership,
But was that on the bus or was it on the train?
And almost all of those were on the train.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Maybe someone can comment on that. Whether it's, you know, bus or train now, we used to have buses on University. Now we have a combination, a much more efficient system. And what is about the estimate of the private sector investment that has occurred along the Green Line due to the new system, the comprehensive train, pedestrian, bike, bus system, what is the approximate private sector investment that has come to that corridor?
The current estimate is $2.5 billion.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Well, I serve on the planning commission for the city of Maplewood, and probably two or three times a year we get staff come in and they talk to us about road work that they have to do in the city. And primarily, my recollection is that roads need to be replaced for two things. Number one, simply because they age, but more importantly, because of their use. And what I don't understand is when people are talking about rapid transit or trains or buses or whatever, I almost never hear about how that, in putting in rail traffic or trains, alleviates the cost of having to replace or repair roads, because that's a savings. If you take cars off of roads, you don't to repair them as often or as much. And that cost never seems to be reflected in the cost savings. And why is that?
I mean, I've got the figure.
I'm happy to, you know, I've been doing this for a long time and I've done those studies and they're very large numbers, and giving people who wish to use it the opportunity to take transit does, as you say, remove a lot of costly wear and tear from the roads. I used to make that argument all the time. For whatever reason, people are not moved by that argument. I don't know why, but on the whole, that is not, in my experience, and Representative Fischer, you report to more voters than I do, that is not an argument that typically, I mean, I usually bury it in a report someplace because I think it's an important one, but it is not something that typically moves people for whatever reason.
And I would have to agree. I think one of the things that comes in is because people, a lot of where I hear the comments more is on the highways and those kind of things. Well, there's all these people taking the highway. Why is it still clogged? Well, because we still have growth going on in the highway. And so they see that kind of thing. Well, I hear it, but I don't see it in the congestion on the roads. And I think that's what it comes back to. At least a couple of people, when I was probing a little bit more, they said, I still see the congestion out there. So are we really saving it or aren't we? You know, that's where I hear pushback. No, that's a point, you know, but at the same time, so if you didn't have it, you'd have even more cards on the road. So it's tough.
Yeah, isn't a bigger issue about the road repair, the trucks that are on the roads? Isn't it more that they do more damage than cars do? I mean, I think if you put 50 cars out there and you put four semis, I think they're going to have a little bit more, you know, they're going to be tougher on the roads than the cars are. Especially when we're driving these smaller cars that are much lighter.
There's been some studies, I think. Will, can you?
We could.
I think you should say,
you're
really.
You're basically right.
Yeah.
But we can do the little experiment. Are there roads that never see semis? Of course, there are. Most residential roads, they deteriorate.
Right.
So there's your.
But they're service trucks, you know, that bring in the refrigerators and those kinds. You'll see those on
it's
the
a pretty small ones.
Yeah.
And that's what they're doing, is they're moving the goods all back and forth that
right.
we need. And so we have
right.
to figure out how do we take care of paying that in an equitable way. And that's kind of where we are, is how do we pay that in an equitable way? Because we do want to make sure things are getting back and forth. And I know that you use rail more, but you still have the final last miles are always coming to us in
right.
some form of a truck. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question.
Yes,
there's a coalition for bigger trucks. Thank you. I can't remember the name of it. Where they're proposing these really mega size semis, which personally I think will create more damage because our roads aren't built.
They're not
built for that. They're not built to carry those. Their argument is there'll be less trucks because they could take more, but
so is it with
I'm having a problem.
I've been hearing a lot on that issue.
I know they were.
Yeah, and I've had some constituents over at that they're concerned about the trucks. And that's why we're reaching out here, because I'm seeing some stuff come in by emails, et cetera, but I want to give others the opportunity to help provide these kind of concerns out there.
Is the state looking at something other than salt put on that road? Salt's the worst thing you can do.
Salt is a big problem out there. It's expensive. They're using different ways of trying to put it down. You see more of this liquid agent that's being added to help make sure that the melting is done more efficient. And the other reason that they're looking at trying to reduce the amount of salt in there is because chlorine is starting to show up in the waters. And some of the waters that we have are starting to show chlorine contaminations that are much higher than they prefer to see. And it's because we have to use so much in this climate. So they're looking for better ways. And they've been finding, you know, it used to be in the past, we used to throw a lot of salt and sand out there, and they used to then went almost straight to salt. Now they've been using less salt and they're using this combination, but it is a problem. They're trying to figure out how to reduce that, but also stay keep the road safe. Then I saw a hand up. Oh, okay.
Oh, yes. I was just going to ask Eric kind of comment. When we look at repairing roads and keeping roads up to date and bridges up to date, people can relate to that because they drive on the roads and over the bridges. But mass transit seems like it's more of a visionary thing that you have to have an eye to the future. I think you were talking about Denver and how they built up Amtrak mass transit. Some of the people that drive on the roads and understand why you want to keep those up to date and maintain don't necessarily share the vision about mass transit in the future. What is there, or are there studies about millennials and what they want, what they need to make it advantageous to have wide mass transit compared to what the individuals here who maybe got their license when they turned six, the day they turned 16, yeah, will hang on to those keys till the day they die.
Well, it's a great question, and there are any number of surveys of millennials and other folks, you know, that ask them, how do you decide where you, a couple of, you know, how are you planning on where you live, what kind of job to get, you know, how are you making your life decisions? And they're fascinating to me and maybe to others because they're sort of counterintuitive in a lot of ways. You mentioned thing one, which was they're not necessarily getting driver's licenses. I mean, it's not that they're getting them and then not driving. They're not getting them, period, okay, which is remarkable to me, even though I work in this field. And then the second thing, which I think is hard for a lot of folks to get their minds around, because it's not the way we did it, is folks are moving to a place first and then looking for a job. And that would never, I'll speak purely for myself, but also for my, we wouldn't, that would, first you find the job and then you go where there's work, right? And it's very difficult to get our head around. But that's why, and I'm, you know, I appreciate these questions. Why do you do it this way versus this way? I'm trying to put myself in, and Representative Fischer trying to put himself in, you know, the folks at 3M are trying to understand how the people who we're trying to recruit thinking. And they're looking at that map and they're saying, well, I can move to Minneapolis and buy two cars at, you know, $10,000 a pop and then pay for all that. Or I can move to San Francisco. The real estate's more expensive, but I don't have to buy a car. Right, and it's one, it's money, it's a hassle, it's a entire, it's a different frame of, and it's very hard for a lot of folks to get there. It's not a criticism, it's just hard for us to think that way because, and again, even though I have a point of view on this, that's not what I did, and I have a younger brother and it is how he's doing it, and it's just really hard, even in the family. Why are you moving there without a job, right? And it's a different way of thinking. But long story, the surveys are really, they're unanimous that the millennials absolutely, I mean, it's not that nobody's moving to places with bad transit, that's mm-hmm. not the case, clearly, but all else being equal, if you can find a spot, and it doesn't have to be rail transit, it can be high quality bus transit, so that's good news, that's their number one requirement, is they don't want to have to buy two cars. They really don't want to have to buy two cars. A lot of other things go with that. They want a certain kind of urban environment, and sometimes in the stats, various statisticians here, it's hard to separate those out. Do you want the vibrant downtown with the 24-hour, you know, things to do? For some people, that's number one, and those places tend to have good transit. So in the stats, those kind of mixed up. But if you do a reasonably good job of asking the questions, respondents will say, no, I want those things, and I want transit, and those are independent. And if I could get that, but no transit, I still have to buy, you know, $20,000 worth of cars. That's a problem for me. So that's a long answer, but I hope it's helpful.
So does improving the quality of the environment or keep it from getting even worse, is that an argument that seems to carry some weight when it comes to talking about mass transit?
I think with younger people.
When you ask about the environment, the environment committee over the last 2 weeks, one of the things they were showing is air pollution and seeing where we see rings of air pollution, some of the highest concentrations of things in the air, right around where the highway corridors are. It's not exclusively, and then there's others that pop up where there's a lot of development going on because you've got all the equipment in those areas. But they do see difference in air quality. So more cars you have off, the more cars that you have that are better on exhaust emissions, the more that helps that, or the more that you have cars off and replaced with something else as another way to get at that also. One of the questions I have for you, Will, I was hearing somewhere along the line that, you know, when businesses are looking for redevelopment, you know, some of them are really like the fact that you have at times areas where you've got an investment that's not going to go away in the infrastructure. Sometimes this I hear, you know, why do we want a bus rapid transit or a rail? How does that look though to a business community? Why do they look at some of those things when we've got a long-term investment in that kind of area. How do they view that, and why do they prefer those kind of things sometimes?
Yeah, I think people want to put their money where there's a certain amount of certainty, and you know, a regular route bus has a lot going for it. One of those things is flexibility, but that's a downside for an investor as well. If you can move that bus line away from my front door, then suddenly my students, customers, you know, whoever, lose how they have to get, they've been getting here, and that makes me very uncomfortable. So if I'm developer Jim Stolpestad, right, now he knows that because of the green line, they're not moving the green line. So he's got people coming through his front door or by his front door consistently. And that certainty is a great thing for him. You know, I think some of the flexibility versus the permanence argument is a little bit of a, I mean, it's a completely legitimate question, but it's a false dichotomy as well. Nobody is proposing, not here, not in Denver, you know, an all rail or an all bus system. Nobody proposes an airline that is only 747s. You have feeder planes, you have the big stuff for going, you know, going higher density corridors, that's what we're talking about here. So I think you need the mix, but it's a great question.
Great questions. We're kind of getting toward the end of our time here. Are there any final questions that anybody has tonight? And then I'm going to come back to our three here in case they have live any closing.
Just a little more on the business. It seems that many of the local chambers, the Minneapolis Chamber, the St. Paul Chamber, seem to have a pretty balanced perspective on we need to do better transportation generally and are willing to invest in it. Yet the state chamber seems to be confused. Any comments on that?
You want to walk into that one? I'm not touching that one. I don't know. I think that it might be because, you know, you've got some chambers that might be in a part of outreaches of the state that are not urban that probably have concerns about, you know, what their needs are look much different than what the needs are here. Maybe that's why. And I'm just speculating. I don't know. That's a question you could probably ask the chamber to get a better answer on. With that, I want to thank our presenters, Joe and Nora and Will here. Do you folks have any final thoughts or comments for us before we break up this evening?
Well, I have one that sort of interweaves with that, which was about, as we look at the, you know, I got to go to Railvolution. If you know what Railvolution is, that's the big, you know, transit conference. Again, this is kind of a new thing. I worked in education and legislature, so it's different. But we really, that transit-oriented development, you know, was that real idea that people really do build things where there's the rail lines. And, you know, in Woodbury with the Gold Line, now the Gateway, is there, Alan Dale was on the tour with the Senate, you know, he went, there was a tour out to LA, and he's going to develop, you know, based on that line. And in the Rush Line that's going to come up through Maplewood, you know, it could really do some great things for our city when you think about, if you're familiar with Frost and English, right, and some of our areas that are really struggling, if it comes up by Maplewood Mall, and it's not set at all, it could go 35E, 61, Vento Trail, White Bear. I mean, there's four different things, but what we do know, I think, when you talk about, you know, transit, and that there is going to be development. And in our city, that's a first ring suburb, doesn't have a lot of, it's all about redevelopment at this point. That's really exciting to us. And that, what I, the sessions I went to at Railvolution really, you know, validated that happened, right? Well, I don't know if you have any, because it does happen. If you build it, they will come, sort of that type of philosophy, we hope. That's good.
Well, everyone, thank you so much for coming out this evening on such a wonderful night. And I hope that you all learned something. I appreciate all of you providing your input and thoughts. I've picked up a few things. This is going to be an issue that we're going to be wrestling with through the rest of this session and probably into the next session also. So as you have other thoughts or concerns, please let me know. I know that as we go forward, I'll be doing more town halls on different issues. We may circle back in. This is the second time I've done one on transit transportation. I'll probably circle it again because it is a big thing that's important to a lot of people. Yes, sir.
Just one more thing I wanted to throw out, and this might be kind of a surprise to the mayor, but I've been on the planning commission for over 15 years. When I first started, Maplewood was about 80% developed. We're now 95% developed. And we know we're going to continue to get more and more people living in Maplewood, which is fine. What I'm concerned with, I think something like 70% of Maplewood is basically one home per lot. And so what we're looking at now in the future is infill, what's called infill. And one of the reasons that I like mass transit is because I think that that would then define areas within Maplewood where we would expect to see a lot of multi-unit development, which could take up more people coming into Maplewood. And rather than seeing single-family home neighborhoods being wiped out and having multiple homes developed on small lots. And so that's one of the things that I think public transportation really provides in terms of trying to provide a space and a place for those people who are going to be coming in the future.
Well, thank you everyone for coming tonight. I appreciate it. One thing I'll mention is I do have a sign-up sheet there. One of the things that I'm a little frustrated with is I contacted a lot of newspapers to get information out about the meeting tonight, and nobody printed it, from the St. Paul to the White Bear Press to everybody else. So it seems most of the people came from my email blast. I wish I had a more effective way to be able to get things out. If people have ideas on that, I'm willing to try different ways to get communications out there, because I think this is real important, and the more people we have being able to come, the greater that we are able to hear the exchange of ideas. So thank you for taking time tonight, and have a great evening.
Thank you.